will be having a teach and preach for church leaders about what we need most to lead people to God. We'll have a look at that.
Well, let's state first of all that the mission of the church is to make disciples, not to make believers. And that's very important. And it's very basic truth, of course, but in the meantime, we sometimes forget that it's important to make disciples, not believers. Let's first have a look at Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20. Go then and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them into the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything that I have commanded you, and behold, I'm with you all the days to the close and consummation of the age. Amen.
Amen.
Please notice that verse 18 says, and that's in front of the other verses, that they would only be able to do all this because Jesus has all the authority in heaven and on earth. Amen. So even the disciples could not do this without the authority given by Jesus. And after he went to heaven, Jesus would give the authority to them by sending the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is very important, but if you really want to be used by God in the power of the Holy Spirit, we also need something else. And that's what I will be talking about this morning. First of all, I'd like to talk with you about two main messages in Holland and also all over the world. And they are basically very good messages, no doubt about it. Good biblical teachings. And messages you've probably heard yourself through the years. So the main messages in the church in Holland and also in other countries were about the need for the body of Christ to live a life full of the Holy Spirit. By obeying God and spending time with Him, we shall receive the power of the Holy Spirit. And we will live an expectant life. A life in which we will be transformed from glory to glory. Are you ready to receive this message this morning?
Yes.
Amen? Okay. Let's have a look at John 3. We'll start with verse 1. John 3. It says, now there was a certain man among the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler among the Jews, who came to Jesus at night and said to him, Rabbi, we know and are certain that you have come from God as a teacher, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. Well, then Jesus immediately gets to the point. You can only enter the kingdom of God after being born again. And it says in Greek, being born from above. Well, that was understood by Nicodemus. It has to come from God, because otherwise Jesus could not have done all those miracles. Amen?
Amen?
That's what it says in verse 2. When you are born from above, God will be with you, like in the Old Testament, that the Holy Spirit would come on you, but also in you, in the new covenant, like he was with and in Jesus. So that's very important. But what Nicodemus did not understand, that he himself needed to be born from above. And Jesus calls it in verse 5, being born from water and spirits. So Nicodemus thought he was a good man, and he was doing the will of God by keeping the Torah. But in order to become a true son and daughter of God, this birth has to be a birth of water and spirits. Well, we know that water has to do with being baptized, leaving your past and who you were behind. And being born of the Spirit means that the fullness of God will enter your being. Let's go to verses 28 up and until 30. You yourselves are my witnesses, says John, that I stated, I am not the Christ, but I've been sent before him. He who has the bride is the bridegroom, but the groomsman who stands by, and the groomsman, that's John, and listens to him, rejoices greatly and heartily on account of the bridegroom's voice. This is my pleasure and joy, says John, and it is now complete. He must increase, but I must decrease. He must increase, and I must decrease. Actually, it says in Greek, he must grow more prominence, and I must grow less so, more in the background. So Jesus in the front, and I should be in the background. So I didn't tell much about me. It's not important. It's about Jesus. That's what I'm here for. Amen. What is needed most in order to make the Lord more prominent in our lives? And after that, we will see to the question, what do we need most of all when leading people to God? So let's now search for the first answer. So what do we need to have the Lord more prominent in our lives and Jesus? We have a look at the Old Testament. We're going to look at Jacob and, no, not Esau, Jacob and Moses. Well, we know the story of Jacob, and you can read in Genesis chapter 25 that he stole his brother's Esau's first birthrights. And how he got in real trouble because of that. Jacob had to run away because his twin brother was about to kill him. He went to his uncle Laban, where he had a hard time, you know that story. He had to work very hard for the woman he loved so dearly, Rachel. But he also had to run away from Laban, his uncle. So he was always on the run. Because he tried to arrange his life by using tricks instead of trusting God. Amen. And how God, as the angel of the Lord, and we know that it was Christ Jesus, the angel of the Lord, one of the foreshadowings of Jesus in the Old Testament. And the angel of the Lord, he fought with Jacob. We can read about that in chapter 32. Well, Jacob was stronger, which was very special. He was a strong man. No question about that. But he could no longer rely on his strength, because the angel of the Lord, after the fight, would touch his hip. You know, the most strong muscles in your body are in your hip. So when his hip was dislocated, he had a limp after the fight. So he could no longer run very fast for the enemy. He had to put his trust on God. Because he had to face his brother Esau now. Well, I'll leave Jacob for the moment. We go to Moses. He served at the courts of Pharaoh. He had been highly educated and was probably very capable of expressing himself. We tend to forget that, that he couldn't talk. He could talk. Yes, he was very clever. But like Jacob, he put his trust on his strength and good thinking. And we know that that resulted in murder. His intentions were good to deliver the people of Israel, but he killed someone for it. And he used force. And the Lord had to learn him that it would not go by might nor by power, but by God's Spirit, like Zechariah 4 verse 6 says. Well, Moses had might and he had power, but it resulted in a long period as a shepherd in which he had to do it, to learn to do it God's way. Amen? Amen. And Moses had already turned 80, and we would say, man, that's really old. But now he was allowed to deliver God's people. But the funny thing is, he asked the Lord for someone else. Isn't that funny? Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, he would be used by God in a powerful way. He had learned to do it God's way and to put his trust in God. Well, what did those two men, Jacob and Moses, have in common? They had become obedient through brokenness. Mm. Amen. In order for the Lord to increase, Jacob and Moses had to decrease. God had to grow more prominent in their lives, and they had to become less so. So now we have the answer to the first question. What do we need most in order for people to be led to God? Brokenness. But why does brokenness help to be more obedient? Let's now see what we receive when we are born again. 2 Corinthians 4 verse 7. That's an important verse. 2 Corinthians 4 verse 7. Where Paul says there, however, we possess this precious treasure in vessels of earth, that the grandeur and exceeding greatness of the power may be shown to be from God and not from ourselves. Well, This is such a vessel, a clay pot. That's what it is. And we know God as the potter, the heavenly potter. And we are a clay pot. We are frail human clay pots. And isn't most of what we do done by me, myself, and I? And that's mostly our inspiration, me, myself, and I. And what does it do? What does it produce then? If we do things from me, myself, and I. Let's read 1 Corinthians 3, verse 12. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 12. Also a well-known verse. Where Paul says, but if anyone builds upon the foundation, which is Jesus, whether it be with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, and straw. Well, this is what wood, hay, and straw look like. So if you do things without doing it for God, and just as the inspiration from me, myself, and I, this is what we produce. Wood, hay, and straw. But hallelujah. There's also something else inside of us, in our clay pots. It's a treasure. Like Paul says, the treasure contains gold, silver, and precious stones. Well, when Jesus becomes more prominent in our lives, yes, then this comes out.
Amen.
Gold, silver, and precious stones.
Amen.
But what do we need then? If Jesus is more prominent in our lives, brokenness. Then what comes out then? Gold, silver, and precious stones. And you might say, well, it's not a nice message, Brother Robert. I don't like brokenness. But do you want to be used in the kingdom of God? Do you want to be used in the kingdom of God?
Yes.
Amen. Admit you're broken. Yet without Him, you will only produce wood, hay, and straw. Amen. Or you might say, well, I admit I'm broken, but I don't want to lose my dignity. Do you see this rose? Please pass the favor onto the podium. Does she smell good?
Yeah.
Does she look good?
Yeah.
She looks perfect, doesn't she?
Yes.
You may be seated. Michael W. Smith wrote a song we all know. Wow. Like a rose, trampled on the ground, you took the fall and thought of me above all. Jesus thought of you and me.
Amen.
He died for you and me.
Amen.
He accepted all the blame. He was made fun of. He was spit in the face. He was struck by fists. His beard was pulled out. You know the Passion of the Christ? His back was scorched in such a way that the organs could even be seen.
Oh,
his lungs,
Jesus.
His kidneys. That's what He did for us. And then He was nailed to the cross. Naked. And above all, He was left by the Father. He was no longer Abba Father, but my God, why have you forsaken me? God had turned His back on His Son, who was dying on the cross. Well, in the Garden of Gethsemane, there was an angel who was sent by the Father to comfort Jesus. But on the cross, there was no Father. It was my God. Why have you forsaken me? It was pitch dark all of a sudden. And the earth was trembling. Of all the things Jesus had to endure, this was perhaps the most difficult thing. being left by the Father. He died for our sins. He had to suffer in a terrible way. Jesus died of a broken heart. He died of a broken heart. Because when a heart is under such stress, it will burst sooner or later. Like a rose trampled on the ground for you and me. Do you feel His love for you? Do you truly feel it? He is your Lord and your Savior, who died for you, losing all dignity. He hung there on the cross naked. Now we get to the answer to the second question. What do we need most of all when leading people to God? Well, the answer is the same. Brokenness. We have to come to the point that we cannot do anything without God. Leading people to God, what do we need most of all? Well, I need brokenness most of all. You need brokenness most of all. We all need brokenness most of all. Perhaps you might say, Brother Robert, I'm broken. What can I do in the kingdom of God? I'm unemployed. I have debts to pay. My partner ran away. I'm not treated in a good way. I'm disappointed in God. Can God use me still? Yes, He can.
Amen.
When you are already broken, He can use you. And I'm not talking about the brokenness as in that you've gone through a lot of hurt in your life, that you have gone through a divorce, which is terrible, that you have a terrible disease, or you've got a lot of other stuff that's really troubling you. It's very difficult. I'm not talking about that kind of brokenness. I'm talking about the brokenness written by King David in Psalm 51, verse 17. My sacrifice to God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. Such a God you will not despise, says David.
Amen.
God can use you to lead people to Him.
Amen.
By simply being who you are, dependent on Him.
Amen.
In your brokenness. Amen.
Amen.
And perhaps you are here this morning. He said, well, Brother Robert, it would have been easier if you would have preached on obedience. Well, it would have been easier perhaps. But I would have left out a very fundamental truth, that obedience only comes out when we're truly broken.
Mm.
Otherwise, it's a trick. Otherwise, it's a trick. It has to come from brokenness. Otherwise, you will not produce gold, silver, and precious stones. You will keep on producing wood, hay, and straw.
Yeah.
So if you don't know that brokenness, and you're convinced that you even have to put down your dignity, look at Jesus. He was hanging there naked on the cross. He lost all His dignity. All His dignity. He couldn't protect Himself. He couldn't even cover His nakedness. He lost all dignity. So, what are you waiting for? If you don't know that brokenness, you can come to the front. You can have a look at the rose, the broken clay pots, and we can pray for you. If you want prayer, this is the moment.